Welcome back to Team Liquid Academy versus Cloud9 Academy. I'm still Captain Flowers. That's still Crumbs. And we're about to hop into this second game.
I'm glad I'm still me. That would be quite concerning if I've changed already.
Bit of an existential crisis after game one. We just gotta shake things up a little bit. Keep Academy nice and spicy for everybody.
Yeah, definitely. Some players might need to shake things up. Some of us might need to also not be fazed by what we just saw. Wukong's still a very top-tier pick, guys.
Yeah, Wukong's still strong. Unfortunate game last time around, but we'll see kind of what we get out of this game here. Right now, Team Liquid is looking a little bit better here in the Academy sphere. They got some aggressive early moves and some good meta reads coming out.
Yeah, I think the big one was that Yusui's now shifting away from those carry supporting junglers like the Karmas or mid laners, and is now moving more into just how can I have as much agency into the game as possible, which was what we always knew him for. So seeing him return to that is also putting Grieg in a better position where he can play those carry champions, but he's not the guy that you need an entire composition around him. He can deliver whether it's supporting you or just being a little bit of an aggressive kindred. So I think the team is really starting to find their footing with Grieg coming back into the lineup and then figuring things out. And now that we got to see also what EG just showed us with the draft, you really get the idea that the meta is really just what are you really good at and what can you synergize with your team best. Obviously, there's some picks that are going to be a little bit stronger than others that are somewhat on permaban, but once that list has been tapered off, it's all about what you can perform on.
I always want to see people following their heart, man. Play what you're good at. On the other side of the rift, Cloud9, you mentioned this when we were talking about things at the beginning of the day, how Academy can feel really streaky for both wins and losses. And C9 started 2-4 in spring in those first 3 weeks, went on to win finals. So this rough start might not be the worst omen for them.
Not at all. And they are still trying some things. Tomo is the one bot laner in Academy that has half his games on Cassiopeia and the other half on Marksman. It worked out in that second game against Golden Guardians last week, but it was a really, really close game that was just won out with some very powerful late game team fights. So the team is still having a hard time finding their footing, but that win, I think, really solidifies their position moving forward and gives them a little boost of confidence, because the first game they had where they had a ginormous lead but were still not able to close things out, I think really hurt them a bit, because they shifted dramatically in their kind of composition, putting Nori back into a more utility-based champion and not so much in the hard carry mode. And it worked for a win, but I still want to see them experiment a little bit more, and it looks like that experimentation is just being given up to the bottom lane, since Tomo is still an unknown factor for us, but it looks like he can't play Cassio.
So here's my big question of the draft for you before we get into things here for this second game. Volibear, banned or no?
Yeah, Volibear, you got to ban it. I think the thing is, it's not about top lane Volibear. Yeah, top lane Volibear is fine, but it's about jungle Volibear that is the problem. In the jungle, he's just too difficult to move out. He has great control over Scuttle. He's got good gank potential. He can't really get 1v1 since he can just run away. And once he hits level 6, he's got great tower dives. He scales like a beast. You need healing reduction. So once you get to a point, no other jungler can really beat him, since you can't really kite him and his healing is too powerful. I can go on, Flowers. There's a lot about Volibear that is too good right now. And if you're not jungling him right now on blue side, you need to be banning him.
Let's see how it all shakes out. We are into the draft for the second game of the day. How's TL and Cloud9 going to do it here? Syndra banned to start things off for the side of TLA. Cloud9 Academy, show me the Varus. There it is. Every single time.
Yeah, just too easy. Too easy to play. You have only one single skill shot that you have to hit. That's on a super short cooldown. Tons of damage. And with all the supporting champions that can protect him, he becomes just such a nuisance. Just glad to see him gone. We want to see a little bit more variety in the bottom lane, because the counterpart that is always mentioned in the same breath as Varus is Ashe, who has a similar engage tool, has a bit of harassy poke, a good laning phase, and is starting to see a little bit more play. Don't underestimate how valuable Hawkshot can be in setting up vision early on. and Yumi and Karma will be taken away from Team Liquid, so keeping away those healing supports. So we're not going to see that Twitch and Yumi combination again, but Volibear is open. I would love to see Team Liquid take it again so we can start to build up the sample sizes that we so desperately need to really gauge this champion properly, because we've already seen enough of what Aphelios does. You know what compositions are built around. There's no surprises here.
I mean, hey, we don't know. I was going to make a cheap 200 years joke. I'm better than that. We're not. Aphelios is really strong. We know what this champion is capable of doing, as you already said. I'm not surprised to see them take it first, but at the same time, Volibear's still open. Cloud9 could pick that one up, but they are going to grab that Cassio that you already mentioned. It's been a part of 50% of the game so far, rising up to 60% here with a lock-in as the first pick for Cloud9 this draft. Trundle will compliment.
No matter how many times Tomo plays Cassiopeia, you always have to respect that it can be flexed. So this is a particularly strong for the red side. Now, it can be a little bit tricky if Palafox's matchup isn't particularly good into Cassiopeia, as Yasui will obviously draft and keep in mind that he could be up against Cassio. But the lane is not going to be too rough if he is against Cassiopeia in the bottom, as Thresh is going to be the best bro in bailing him out of a potential gank. Come on, let's pick Volibear.
I was going to say, I'm waiting for the Volibear. That's literally what I've been waiting for the whole time. I want to see if they go for it, or maybe they're not confident in it. I'm not. Oh, nope, never mind. There we go. All I had to do is cast or curse it, man. That's all I had to do. Say, nah, they won't pick it. Boom, Volibear locked it.
It can be still top. I think Jenkins had a game of Volibear recently, but again, it's just about the bot lane. He can have negative matchups in the top lane. Jace can be particularly tricky, although hammering him away doesn't necessarily stop him. He just gets a reset on his Q, so he is ever so relentless in his pursuits, which is quite fitting. I think they're really doing their research on what bears are actually like, because they
wait. Do you think that's like the reason Volibear's Q has that reset on CC is because somebody at Riot read a book of what bears do and they're like, no, guys, you don't understand. If you hit a bear with a hammer, he ain't stopping.
That's what I would hope, that there's some consistency in what the animals are actually like and that they go for it. Like for example, don't you think that somebody looked up or thought about scorpions? It's like, yeah, when you get stung by a scorpion, you're just dead. You die. Like, you should make it so that his ult should be that the second you get hit, you're done. Like, I thought that makes sense.
You know what, buddy? You're right. I should have thought about it. It's all about the... So wait, aren't you supposed to... No, wait, you're not allowed to run away up a tree from a bear because a bear can climb a tree. I was going to say, what if you climb up a tree? Can't the bear just not get you anymore? But no, he can't. That's the problem with that. Let's go back into the draft. Let's see what we got here. It's Nautilus picked up for the side of
wait
C9A.
Wait a minute, what? Okay, hold on,
Nautilus.
You're just... Okay. That Kindred right. ban is completely assuming that it's going to be a top lane bully bear, right?
Yes. 100%.
So I think that's too many assumptions to make right now to throw that, especially if you're going to be going with a safe blind matchup like the Gangplank. So that could be a ban that Cloud9 would have liked in a different rotation, but maybe they just don't want to see more of Griggs Kindred. It is a very pesky pick so far. I just think that we've already started to see the power of having more variety in your top lane and then just having a big, powerful jungler like Volibear.
We've got a pretty powerful top laner picked up for C9 with that Gangplank, and we've got Vlad drafted here for Team Liquid Academy. So a couple solo laners with a lot of high scaling potential here for either side. What's the last one going to be, Team Liquid? We still have a lot of questions to answer. Is Volley top or jungle? Is Vlad top or mid? Who's this last pick going to be? Who's the mystery man or woman of the last pick of Team Liquid Academy? And it is Corki! All right, so Corki mid, Vladimir top, Volibear in the jungle.
This is why I thought the Kindred ban was a little foolish. It could very easily be jungle Volibear. So it is going to be the Vlad top into the Gangplank and then Corki into Kassadin. So Kassadin can be fairly powerful here. We have a similar case of the last time that we saw Volibear in the last matchup, where you have a team that just had a ton of scaling parts. Cloud9's late game is absolutely menacing whereas Team Liquid is trying to offset that with having a ton of carries, but a single frontline in Volibear. So we get to see just how powerful he can work as a one-man tank army, which with the Stone Point active, looks to be he can be pretty damn good at that.
I mean, with both teams having so much scaling in top, in mid, and in bottom lane, this better be a bloodbath. This better not be some LCK Spring 2020 Resident Sleeper game where there's 3 kills at 46 minutes. I want to see this 6 carry game just turn into absolute mania here as we move forward. I'm ready for it.
I will rest your worries, Flowers. This is LCS Academy. We are never getting that stalemate. There is always some action happening. So despite the fact that we have scaling on both sides, you know that they want to just use their CC as soon as possible because that's just the way the players are.
And once again, we get to see the Volibear. Like you already said, the sample size will be fun to sort of keep track of. We saw a really good first game in the previous match. Evil Geniuses Academy doing well with it so far. We'll see how it goes this time around. We're going to step away to build up some of that game delay. But once we come back, we will have the game from the start. Don't y'all go anywhere.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. We saw Champ Select. The delay has been taken care of, and we're just about ready to jump into game. But during the break, I was thinking, Crumbs. I was thinking about the conversation that we had during the Champ Select one. Not the relevant conversation, but the one about Bears.
Oh, I know where this is going.
Yeah, the one about Bears. And so I was thinking, if you can't run away from them, and you can't stop them from running at you or run up a tree, you got two choices that logically came to mind for me. You either play dead and hope the bear goes away, or you do the shark thing and punch it in the nose. I don't know which one works.
I think there's three choices here, Flowers.
Wait, there's a third?
Yeah, there's a third. So you can't run away for sure. You can punch it, which you would do like a Leonardo DiCaprio in The Revenant, right? Just fight the bear out.
Yeah, you got to punch it in the nose, though. In the nose, because that's what works in the sharks.
So you're still fighting it, but you're punching it in the nose. But the third is that if you're with someone, you can just push that person forward, and then you get away.
Whoa! You're the Benedict Arnold of the two. You're the I don't got to be faster than the bear. I just got to be faster than my friend type of guy, huh?
I'm just giving you the options. I'm not telling you which one I would take. If I was in that position, I would take the second option and team up with my friend. But if they're not up to it, it's like, well, survival of the fittest at this point.
Just throw them under the bus.
If they don't want to fight the bear and it's just going to be a him or me versus the like to stay alive, what choice is he giving me? I gave him an option. We could fight the bear together.
So you're saying you propose teamwork, and if your ally refuses said teamwork, you int them.
Yes,
so,
exactly.
So it's like solo queue telling someone, come dive top. He doesn't dive top, so you just dive top alone and die.
Yeah, but in this scenario, they somehow die off of my diving.
Right. Okay, let's redo it. You tell the dive top. He doesn't come and dive when you want him to. You end up losing your position in the lane, and then when he finally does come top, you wait for him to dive and then abandon him.
Yep.
So then he dies. Okay.
Yep, that's it. That sounds about
right. All
right,
we're on the same page. That's what's very important. And now that we've taken care of this just incredibly critical discussion, we're into the game, ladies and gentlemen. Team Liquid Academy, C9 Academy, squaring off here. Second time we're going to get to see the Volley Bear run and press the attack as the rune. Going to be able to get that 3-hit exposure to amplify the damage coming out of the rest of the team. Not seeing anything really standing out to me otherwise here on this Team Liquid side. Across the bridge, we see Fudge with the Grasp of the Undying there on the Gangplank. Press the attack also on Trundle. Very standard stuff. Fleet Footwork for Kassadin, which is the usual choice when he's going to be taking a lot of poke there in the lane. Everything is normal. 3 teleports on the side of Cloud9 Academy. 2 for the side of Team Liquid Academy, meaning there will be that extra combat power in bottom lane with the heal for Rikara.
Yeah, and there's certainly a lot of combat power with a Cassiopeia in the bottom lane, and this is good that the top laners do not give a leash. This is really important for Vladimir, because if Gangplank catches you in a brush coming into the lane level 1, you lost the lane right then and there. So the fact that Grig gets to start by himself will help his top laner out significantly, as that's the dream. You don't really want to do a whole lot for Vladimir. You just want to let him do his thing, but so is Fudge's game plan. So a lot of this matchup just comes down to the skill and how they can play it. Bush control is a big thing, since Gangplank is just going to continue to go for this every single time, right? Trying to get 4 stacks of Grasp of the Undying and then peek out of the brush, hit you with a Q, and literally do that all laning phase long. That is what Gangplank is about.
I was about to say, I know that you're giving me an honest analytical breakdown of this matchup right here, but saying it's all about the skill as we watch Gangplank repeatedly hover over his opponent's champion and press Q on cooldown is a little bit interesting. Gangplank's laning pattern is just so obnoxious to deal with. It's pretty much anyone.
You look at your buff icons and you're like, okay, 1 stack of grass, 2 stacks of grass, 3 stacks of grass, 4. Okay, Q. All right, back into the brush. 1, 2, 3, Q. And that's it. That's Gangplank for you in a nutshell. It gets tricky when you have your barrels, but obviously you're going to hit level 2 first, and then you're just going to skill that, auto it, wait for the little cycle to burn again, cue the barrel, and go in. So just how Fudge showed it, which got Jenkins' flash, because the barrel wouldn't be enough to kill him, but if he flashed with his flaming sword and then queued him after, he would have certainly gotten first blood. So Vlad just respecting that GP early on is an absolute menace.
And remember that once Vladimir gets some levels up to level 7, and particularly level 9 in the transfusion, he'll be able to do just fine in sustaining himself and dealing with this a bit better. But early on, man, the Gangplank gun spam is just, it's the absolute worst, especially if he can get that first back that he wants and make sure that he acquires the sheen so each poke is pretty much twice as strong. It's more than a nuisance. It's just a pain in the butt. And Nori back into his own side of the jungle after taking the topside crab. Nobody's getting 2 crab today. crumbs. The first game, Dardock got two crabbed. Nobody's getting two crabbed here in this one.
Yeah, it's good. You really don't want to start getting two crabbed. It is a big advantage. You can play the crab rave once you get that and just feel good all day long from that. And I was just thinking about what you said about Gangplank's play pattern and what was Vladimir's play pattern. And to me, Vladimir strikes me as revenge. He's a vengeful champion because he knows he's going to have a terrible time in laning phase in the beginning. But once he hits that spike, he's like, uh-huh, you remember that Q spam you gave me before? Now I'm going to show you what real Q spam looks like. And so then he turns into the bully in the laning phase. So that's kind of what the Vladimir just wants to do. He just wants to survive your initial punishment and just build that grudge inside of what you just did to him, farm quietly, and then make sure that you can just fight him later on, which is exactly what we're starting to see now. Is he's at full HP, has only burned his potion, while Jenkins is running low in mana and has a single biscuit to keep his mana up.
Yeah, Vladimir's laning is sort of like the equivalent of those social media posts where people say be careful who you bully in middle school, and then they show off how successful they are now that they're grown up. Like, poor level 1 Vlad, he's getting thrown into lockers, they're taking his lunch money, it's just a bad time for him. But man, once he grows up, he goes to a good college, he makes the right connections, now he's making like $1 million a year, he's got a super cool car, everything's great for Vlad now. And he's just owning the lane. Of course, he's not quite there yet, he's level 5, so he's still got some more college to do. But you get what I'm saying.
Yeah.
It's gonna be good for Vlad later on.
Have you been to your high school reunion?
No.
So mine was supposed to happen this year. Not happening anymore, but
yeah, that's probably not going to work out too well in COVID world. But bottom side, we got a play coming in. We got a gank going off. We got Grig showing up here into the bottom lane. Diamond's in some trouble. Damage going down. First blood over to Team Liquid Academy.
Look at how quickly Team Liquid responds with the teleports to help out as well. Despite Inori being there, you just can't beat the fact that a Corki is also TPing. So maybe you could have flashed in to try to take out the Thresh and trade a 1-for-1, but it's the power of that teleport that prevents you from doing that. And Yasui's only going to miss out on a little bit of CS, but he's hoping to nullify that advantage with a Cole that he just got. So let's see how it happened here.
Yeah,
the Lantern just gets him so much faster, right? Inori was just a little bit farther behind than the Volibear, but the Lantern play just makes it that Volibear's gap closing is immediate.
Volibear getting involved in First Blood here yet again, my friends.
Okay, let's see if this didn't really count for the first game of the day.
What do you mean it didn't count?
Okay, do you remember that First Blood?
I mean, there were a lot of bloods in the top lane in game number one. Let's not be dishonest about it. So I'm not gonna lie. I don't specifically remember which one happened first
because
they
I'll
all kind of blurred
you,
together.
Wukong jumped Volibear with the clone forward and died.
Oh yeah, that part. Okay, yeah you're right.
So to me, I'm like, okay, you did get involved in First Blood, but I don't want to put that in your stats. I don't really want to put that anywhere. That's the one outlier. Like, we need some stats.
It still counts, man. It's still First Blood. That's still how it went down. Like, I don't know. It's still, when I look at the stats page, that's still going to show up as Volibear being a part of that. Volibear was still there. So that's now two games where Volibear has been participatory in First Blood. He is instrumental in the success of this happening. Whether or not his opponents put themselves in a bad spot beforehand, that's a detail. That's extraneous information. We are looking simply at death by champion before any other champion on a gamely basis by a bear. That's what they would record it if it was an official stat. And Volibear is in there, man. Volibear is making it happen.
Bear is involved in blood. That's a good stat to see. And another one I want to see track out of Voli is actually the farm, because that's the one thing you would think, okay, surely a champion that's involved in so many First Bloods, so good at tower diving, so good at tanking, will have some sort of deficiencies. Well, last game he was able to keep up and farm with Graves, and this time around he's ahead of the Trundle, despite already being involved in the first kill, so that's the one thing that is interesting to me, just how quickly can Volibear power farm. And from the stats of Silicon, the look of him, it looks like very easily, but an engage onto Yama.
Yama's in some trouble.
Nope. Not today.
Nope. The subjugate is strong enough. The continued ticking down of the HP will be enough to take him out. He was also standing in the at the very edge of the Gangplank Ultimate, so even if the Trundle Ulti wasn't able to finish him, I think the very edge of the Cannonball Explosion probably would have got him there, and it looks like the reward for Cloud9 is the opportunity to take this first rip.
It is a four-man gank, really, in the bottom lane, punishing the lack of flash of the Thresh, so Cloud9 already knowing exactly where they can strike fairly easily. They don't need to overextend anywhere else to try to look for a gank that isn't going to play into their hands. And you feel great if you have your Gangplank and your Kassadin farming away, and you know that when the Volibear gets to be that tanky beast diving in, the Cassiopeia is going to be able to melt him down, especially with the Subjugate stacked on top of him. So I think Cloud9 knows that this game they can pace themselves quite well, despite the fact that Team Liquid is also taking that same approach with the double Cole on their marksman.
Double Cull, and one other item that I want to point out that's really nice here. I already mentioned how the core early laning item of the Gangplank is the Sheen. You want to get that as fast as possible to really juice up those Qs. But as soon as he gets the Sheen, Fudge doesn't get greedy and say, oh, I need Trinity Force ASAP, oh, big item spike, raw. He goes for the Executioner's Calling. He's up against a champion that relies heavily on healing. He's up against other champions on the enemy team that will be able to heal as the game moves forward. This is a very good pickup. I love the fact that he got this nice and early. Jenkins also responding properly by going for the early Seeker's Arm Guard. Has an incredible gold efficiency once you get the stacks on it. Both these guys itemizing properly here for this top lane battle. And Jenkins, Crumbs, he is one level away from having that top tier transfusion.
And you know, the crazy thing about the Cole that you point out from Fudge is that he loved this item, so the Executioners, he loved it so much for this matchup, he actually got it first. It was his first build against Vladimir. He was sick of what Jenkins was doing to him, just queuing away and healing, which, yeah, you can slightly affect it, but Jenkins can just wait this out and instantly queue back in every transfusion. So despite it being a good item for dealing with a lot of champions that heal in the laning phase, because it sticks for so little, the healing debuff, Jenkins can really just play around the debuff and continue to queue away at the minions and stay topped off. So it's going to be much more effective when it comes to those all-ins and less for, hey, I just want to try to whittle away the Vladimir and keep him away from full HP, since he just has to wait a few seconds for the buff to wear off like this, right? 1 second and bam, there you go. Now queue the wave next time and you're good.
Saving the empowered Q to use it on Fudge himself as opposed to just a minion. Exactly what you want to see the Vlad doing. And Crumbs, this game is even, man. I'm looking at the farm. One difference in top, one difference in jungle, no difference in mid.
Oh.
Now Jenkins is about to die. We'll see if he actually does. Fudge flashing forward, having a flash back out now. Good move coming out there from Fudge. If Jenkins didn't immediately flash, he would have been dead.
But yet he can stay in lane still, and let's see what HP he ends up at after this all-in, right? Because you would hope that Vladimir will feel like, okay, I can't stay in this lane anymore, but so far, right, he gets to farm the wave, he'll get to base, he catches an entire experience, and he doesn't even get to use the teleport since Fudge is saving his as well, so he can just save his and save it for another play in the bottom lane, which is what we'll likely see both top laners using it for. So despite Fudge getting both flashes out of Jenkins, it really hasn't translated to much, as he's able to keep up and farm and still not lose many turrets. He's only lost a single plate.
Yeah, not bad at all, honestly, up there in the top side and hitting that level 9 in a good spot now moving forward. You can see him after the Seeker's Arm Guard going for the typical CDR garage sale early on that Vlad will do. Vlad typically going for all the CDR possibilities in his runes. When you go Phase Rush as the main keystone, you'll generally take Transcendence. You'll have Cosmic Insight in your Inspiration secondary. You'll also have the first row of your stat-based runes be Scaling, Cooldown, Reduction. So then all you gotta do is grab this little bit of Garage Sale here with two different 10% CDR items in the actual items you purchase, and you'll be set to hit that 45% as the game moves forward, exactly where Jenkins wants to be. Grig is up here in this top side, and now we're gonna see Jenkins get a little bit more hypey, try to bait Fudge into making something happen here. But you can see the ping showing up. They know. They've seen Grig.
Well, not only did they see him here, they saw him much earlier. They're gonna go for a dive, but here's a TP.
Oh. This is going to turn into an absolute mess, I hope. Here we go. Palafox showing up. Yasui in some trouble. Man, he is instantly dead. There was no chance to get out of that one. Jenkins into the puddle. and that puddle is quickly going to be mopped up. It is a double kill for Flood.
Oh, so we have another fight in the bottom lane before we get to that.
Oh, no. Oh, no. Rikara. All right. He should be safe. He should be safe. Tomo nearly grabbing the kill onto both, but narrowly missing out on either.
So it actually wasn't the fact that Grig just walked around the minion wave and got spotted. It was when he went into the lane in the first place, he went through the river, and there was a ward there. So there was so much time for Cloud9 to see what was happening that they just had to move slowly to the top lane, and they were able to react quickly enough, on top of the fact that you have a Cassidy with teleport. So it's the right vision from Fudge that was able to make it so that his team could counter gank it quite well. And then with the win in that 2v2 bottom lane, they secure their second dragon of the game. This is looking like a really good opening game from Cloud9 with the scaling composition. Look at that. Inori's already here, right? They know what's happening.
Yep. They know what's going down, and by the time they try to force it, it's too late.
It's a flash on the Vladimir, too. You know he can't escape. He just throws the ultimate, because why not? You know you're not getting out of this one. And you would hope that the kills would have gone over to the Cassidy, but we also know that a Gangplank can carry. Uh-oh, Jenkins got hit by that.
Jenkins, will he be able to outplay this time? Damage coming? No, he won't. No, he will not. The ulti from Fudge is enough. And there's your Gangplank solo kill. That is a 3-0-1 Gangplank 15 minutes into the game, Crumbs. That is a scary proposition, my friend.
The second he got hit by that barrel and then pulled after, that was it. There was no way out of that one. And with the Trinity Force this early, Jenkins is not going to be able to lane very effectively here. He's going to have to wait for the wave to sit at his turret the whole time, and Gangplank can just control it and not let that happen, because there's not a lot that the rest of the Team Liquid lineup can force. How do you force onto the Nautilus Cassiopeia that's having such a good time into the bottom lane? And you certainly are not making a play onto Palafox in the mid lane. So far, the downside of what I'm seeing here, Flowers, is that we might see Volibear with a struggling game, despite him being such a powerful pick.
You can see him with the Spectral Cowl in inventory, wants to prioritize his defense against both Cassidy and Cassiopeia. Understandable, since Cassio will be able to just machine gun those Twin Fangs into him as he tries to frontline. But that's always one of the worst feelings, when the enemy team has more of one kind of damage. In this case, they have more AP damage. But the one guy they have of the other kind is fed. That just feels the worst as a frontliner, because there's no winning move. You just have to pick which boot you want to be kicking your butt.
The only positive that Grig can come from that is, he can get from that, is that that magic resistance item is going to make him a lot tankier, despite him facing someone like Gangplank, because it's going to turn into that Spirit Visage, which is huge for Volibear. The extra healing will be fantastic. Now he'll probably have to go just full tank boy from this point onwards, because there's no point in trying to itemize damage at this point. You're never going to dive a single of the members out of Cloud9, and even hits him with the spam emote after he misses the hook when Volibear was in the area. So he didn't even know that Voli was there. He just lets him know, even if you try to gank me, your skills are not good enough to catch me.
He's trying to catch Palafox here, but I can tell you this, Crumbs, from many games that I have played as Skarner, who is also a champion that has no gap closer. Chasing after a spam my gap closer champ like Cassidy, it's generally a feels badman. And speaking of a feels badman, Rikar is about to experience that right here, right now. But don't worry, he's got Yama to be there with him the whole way back to the spawn platform. Four-man dive from Cloud9 Academy here, bottom lane, gets the job done. And it also gets them their next turret.
You could actually go further and say it's a five-man dive, since you sent the Gangplank ultimate down there. The most fed member also wanted to participate in that play. The big one here is not only the teleport, it's just a standard move, but watch the Cassiopeia ultimate. It even catches both members, which is pretty impressive.
Then, yep, it's just, it's easy money for Cloud9. Nobody else is around to be able to potentially respond to this from the side of Team Liquid Academy. And these good plays being made topside and bottom side by the side of C9A, utilizing teleports both times to get the job done have put them in a spot where they're up, what is this, almost 4,000 gold, 18 and a half minutes into the game. That's no small lead.
Oh, and it's only going to get bigger here because Team Liquid doesn't have a way to start a fight if it's not for Grig. Grig is the only way they can get anything going. Vladimir and Corki are never the ones to initiate a fight. They need so much frontline, and so is Aphelios. This is a similar over-indexing in a certain style of composition as when you see a Jace and a Nidalee kind of comp. You need more frontline and less damage. You already have plenty of damage with a Corki and a Aphelios. This is where a tank top laner with a lot of utility and crowd control would be very beneficial. And now we have someone that gives more gold over to Cassidy.
Oh, the flash follow is there and Palafox gets him. Jenkins. Oh, what? These top lane battles today. This one obviously not to the degree of game number one, but both times now we've seen one of the top laners just end up in this position where they're not even able to defend themselves anymore as Diamond starts off the fight here. They're able to find a lot of damage down onto Yama, who keeps himself alive with a stopwatch, flashing away now, and Nori in hot pursuit while the rest of Team Liquid Academy is able to chase down Tomo and find the kill onto him. Rikara looking to kite himself away from this one, but Nori is able to find the damage kill going over to Fudge with the ulti there, and Grig stands in the middle of four. Fudge taking priority to kill Yasui before turning back onto the bear. Maybe that's how you do it, Crumbs. Maybe you don't need to punch him in the nose. Maybe you don't need to run up a tree. Maybe you don't need to play dead. Just rat-a-tat-tat, pull out the pirate gat, and all of a sudden, the bear is done. Clean up at the end of this fight by the side of Cloud9, and they will take their third elemental drake of the game.
We figured it out. Pirates are the counters to bears, so there you go. If you ever, you're ever in some trouble in the woods, you just know that do your best pirate impression, and it just might work. Now, you must have slayed some vampires previously, so you need pirates that are trained in vampire slaying.
So you need a pirate with a clove of garlic and a crucifix and some holy water. That's
some
how you're going to get rid of a bear.
Villain right here.
This is perfect. This is the good stuff. That's what I like to see, man. Team Liquid Academy, though, this is not what they like to see. 6,000 gold down. This game's quickly just getting out of their reach completely.
Oh, yeah. And that fight started with engaging onto the Nautilus because that's the only person that was in range. So Gray jumps onto Tomo, but there's just no follow-up, right? The composition is not built to assist the Volibear diving. So I think we actually have a really cool way to contrast this with what Evil Geniuses Academy drafted in the last game, where if you have a Volibear diving in, you can have the Rumble Equalizer on top of him to make sure that the lockdown that he brings gets amplified by the Rumble damage, or you even have an Irelia to help him out, and the Twitch and the Yumi. So I think there's a lot more cohesion there, whereas I think what Team Liquid just put together here is more of a, we think Volibear is just strong, so we're going to have him, and then everything else around them is not necessarily going to play into those strengths, which is a trend that we're seeing a ton in Academy games, and even LCS games, actually. Hell, games all around the world. It's the change in the meta with the jungle picks, where so many champions are now viable that we're starting to just see people trying to fit them into any composition instead of remembering to not break the fundamental rule of just the synergy and how your composition wins in the first place. Because with Grig being the single person to jump in and nobody to follow him up, he's just fodder for a Cassiopeia.
Well, we're talking about, you say don't break the fundamental rule here. I don't want to see Cloud9 Academy break the fundamental rule of don't throw the game now that you've got this lead, because they're at a point where I honestly don't think Team Liquid Academy wins this without Cloud9 turning this from a game of League of Legends into a game of catch and just tossing it back and forth. I think they completely have everything under their control. This Kassadin needs one more level, and he's at why does this exist in the game territory of people being like, how do I play against this, right? Palafox is popping off so far. Also having double stacking items, both fully stacked, incredible gold efficiency. Not only does he have a ton of gold, it's doing more work than everybody else's gold on the map is doing thanks to the kinds of items he is purchasing. By the way, Gangplank is 6-0-3, has the Essence Reaver, has the Trinity Force, has the next BF sort of the inventory. I want to see Cloud9 just put this one away, and it looks like they're going to do so. Grig gets himself out. He will stay safe thanks to the ultimate, but that's a pretty big tool out of the picture, and that means Cloud9 Academy goes straight to Baron.
I mean, look at what just happened. That was the jungle and support melting Volibear. They almost killed Volibear by themselves. Imagine if you have a carry there. It is just not close right now. So if Cloud9 wants to throw this one, it would be the greatest throw in the Academy we have seen so far, because these champions are just about hitting their strongest spike, and there's not much Team Liquid can do about it. It's a good engage with the Equalizer, but how can anybody else get in there?
Nice damage coming out from Jenkins there to make sure he's able to grab a kill.
Oh, Sui
also getting one onto Tomo, and Norian Diamond very low here. Palafox still in decent shape in terms of health, but with mana almost gone, they can't mount any sort of a counterattack here. It is a 2-for-2, but you said it last game, Crumbs. You said when you're behind, you take those even trades. And when you're behind, you're going to take those even trades if you're Team Liquid.
Oh, especially if you take away some Barons. That is a really good opportunity for them. I'm surprised that they actually were able to get those kills in the first place, considering how strong Cloud9 was. Then you got that Gangplank shutdown, so that was 650 gold into the pockets of Team Liquid. Now, a lot of it will have to come down to Yasui. He had that package, which is what made him so strong in that fight, being able to get into the backline and then quickly get out. But now that Kassadin is level 16, I think he's just going to hunt him down.
Here we go. Dun-dun. Dun-dun. I couldn't even do the third shark in the water dun-dun before he blew the corky all the way up, dude. There is no way to escape the level 16 Kassadin. He is beyond a champion. He is beyond a simple player character. He is a force of nature in this game.
There should be a different animation for him when he gets to get a Cloud Soul as well, because that is one of the few champions that when you give Cloud Soul to, not only stacking the Cloud Souls in the first place, making his ultimate just crack mode at that point, but now he gets even faster when he pops them. Like, how do you escape?
You don't. That's the answer. It's one of those questions where the only answer is no. And for Cloud9 Academy, they now have themselves another huge bonus in the Cloud Soul. Once Tomo drops the ulti, that snake is going to slither so damn fast. You will not be able to escape the follow-up damage from the Twin Fangs. Same for the fact that once Inori uses that ultimate, he will be able to stick to the target he's looking to pursue and weaken with that Subjugate. A lot of utility, a lot of value here from this soul to the side of C9A. Push continuing down the mid lane now. Still 25 seconds left on the Baron power play. They're up to plus 3,200 gold here now that that second turret has fallen in the mid lane, and they want to try to use this minion wave to do some damage to the tier 3. Hook finds its way onto Fudge, but Fudge finds his way into an orange, and he is going to be just fine. Jenkins looks to make some sort of a move here, but there you go. Three Twin Fangs, bada bing, bada boom. The fight is over. Team Liquid trying to get themselves away, trying to make sure that Palafox and Cloud9 Academy aren't able to clean anything else up. Palafox sort of ints it a little bit. He just kind of runs into four. He's feeling himself. He's thinking, all right, I got this. This is my montage. Let's get in there. 1v4, quadra kill, put it on Reddit. Nah. Unfortunately not. His opponents had plenty of damage. They were able to shut him down. But that is an inhibitor taken down in the bottom lane. It will likely be an inhibitor taken down here in mid. Needs a couple more auto attacks to do it. But Team Liquid hold the line. They only lose the one inhibitor.
If Kassadin had a stopwatch and flash, that actually would have been a super hypey play. You can flash on the enemy with your stacked Riftwalk and then Zhonya's while you wait for your cooldowns and your team to collapse. But it was not the items that he had. He did not have that play. He was just feeling that speed, like you're saying, right? It's like when you got a new car, you're like, oh my god, this is so fast, I gotta try it, and then you crash and like, oh crap, I didn't even get insurance yet, I'm just wasting all that money.
Yeah, that is definitely not ideal. If you're watching this from home right now, please don't drive your new car so fast that you're not able to buy insurance before you total it. That's really not the way to live your life. But I think that the Cloud9 car is far from totaled here. I think these guys are going to be just fine moving forward. Still 9,000 gold ahead of their opponents. Still in complete control over the entire map. Team Liquid getting very familiar with the sights, smells, and sounds inside their base, because they're not leaving anytime soon.
Actually, the opposite thing happens, right? You're so familiar with the smells, you don't even smell it anymore. They forgot what the base smells like. It's like, what? All these corpses in here? Not nothing. It just smells like home.
My base smells like base. That's how I like my base to smell. As the mid lane inhibitor slowly regenerates HP, but still not even back up to half. Vladimir brave enough to leave the base there on the bottom side, trying to push out some of those super minions. Jenkins will likely just clear this wave and head on back. Way too dangerous to extend out any further. Yasui has package ready for delivery here. That is one advantage this team has. Remember, that's what they used in the team fight after the Baron to be able to go 2 for 2, make that fight even. Can Yasui get a good delivery here? That's the question. Or will Cloud9 properly play around it and wait for it to dissipate?
Well, they don't have the Vlad teleport again, which was what they used to buy some time in that last fight. So without the TP, Yasui's kind of going in by himself. You'd want Grig to also participate in that, and the pillar will force the package right away, so not much that he can do with that. But the range disadvantage that Cloud9 has is really what's slowing them down from taking this inhibitor, which really makes you wonder, would this game have been over had Kassadin not died in that earlier push? I think so, but a new fight is starting right now.
Diamond's going in. Yama's been hooked, but now the counterattack comes out. Grig is tanking up there in the middle of everybody, but Team Liquid backed themselves away. Re-engage coming out from Diamond. I swear the Nautilus Q hitbox is not a box, it is a truck. But it is a return kill coming out from the side of Team Liquid. They managed to take down Palafox. It's Rikara scaling up. Sometimes, Crumbs, sometimes you just need a little bit of Aphelios magic to hold on to hope. Rikara with the Infernum can clear out these waves instantly and just do incredible amounts of damage. Team Liquid, they lose the second inhibitor, but they're not done yet. They also lose the Nexus turret, but they're not done yet.
I'm not believing because I don't want to believe, Flowers. This game should be over from Cloud9 standards, but if there is any hope from Team Liquid, it is that you have that Aphelios, like you're saying, and they are getting a ton of gold funneled into their carries from the inhibitors being broken down. Now, Inori does have Flash and has Smite, and there is no Corki here. He does have TP, but he'll have to get into the base, so this looks like Cloud9 could just take the Baron for a ride here and end the game. They're gonna pull out, and Yasui is still not here. Nope, they just take out.
What did I say?
Bye-bye.
The pirate is able to be the natural counter to the bear. He grabs a double. He takes down Aphelios. Make it a triple. Thresh is gone too. Can they find themselves some more? Yasui jumping forward. Palafox saying it's level 16, bro. See ya. And that's the ace for Cloud9 Academy. No casualties in the process. Palafox stepping up there with low HP. One shot in the enemy mid laner. And that is all she wrote. 31 minutes in. C9A take the win.
Ah, solid draft advantage out of them. And then all about Fudge this game. Played it super well into the top lane. Had so many advantages. And with the crucial ward that they got, that counter gank, the game was pretty much at a check position from the very beginning. We're using chess analogies here because it seems like everyone's playing chess now in the quarantine days.
Yeah, a lot of people are playing chess, but we're going to replace the horse piece with a bear. And we're going to replace what's the best piece to counter the horse in chess?
Oh, maybe
we're going to replace the queen with a pirate, because nothing beats the queen, and this game, nothing beat the pirate. It was such a pop-off show from Fudge there in the top side. After that initial play, turning things around there, getting themselves a couple of kills, it was multi-kill after multi-kill until the sun went down on Summoner's Rift here in this second game. We're going to step away, but we'll catch you here on the other side as we prepare for Immortals Academy going up against Golden Guardians Academy for Game 3. Don't you go anywhere.